guys, you are welcome to DSS Genation. So if this is your first time watching a video from DSS Genation, do make sure to subscribe and hit the bell button so we can notify you when we create any video. So today we are going to be talking about liver cirrhosis. So pick your paper and your pen and let's get started. Hey guys. Yeah, welcome back. So today we're going to be talking about liver cirrhosis. Liver cirrhosis. Now, the word liver, we understand that that is just an organ of the GIT. But the word cirrhosis in front of it, the word cirrhosis means an irreversible scarring and fibrosis. That is the meaning of what? Of cirrhosis. So if you say liver cirrhosis is just an irreversible scarring and fibrosis of the liver. So because this scarring is irreversible, so it eventually leads to death. It eventually leads to what? To death. So when the liver cells are damaged, they are going to become scarred. So like, what is the meaning of this scarring? This scarring is just what is formed after a damaged tissue. So if a cell within our body system is damaged, so when it's trying to repair itself, it's going to form some kind of scars. So fibrous tissue is going to be there. So fibrosis is to result. So when an healthy cell is replaced with what? An injured one. So scar is formed. So this liver cirrhosis, when a cell of the liver is damaged, so it is going to lead to what? Irreversible scarring and fibrosis. So, and because this irreversible scarring, this scarring and fibrosis, because it is irreversible, it is really progressive. So it is irreversible, it can be cured. So they used to call liver cirrhosis the end stage liver damage. So they used to call liver cirrhosis the end stage liver damage, because it's irreversible, it's going to lead to death at last. Now, what are the causes of liver cirrhosis? So anything that can damage the liver, such as alcoholism, so increasing the intake of alcohol, so excessive intake, right? Let's say that. So excessive intake of what? Of alcohol. So it can damage the what? It can damage the liver. So any kind of injury to the liver can also cause liver cirrhosis. And apart from that, hepatitis B virus. So, invasion of the liver by what? Hepatitis B virus can lead to what? Can lead to liver cirrhosis. So, invasion of hepatitis C virus as well. Hepatitis C virus can also lead to what? Can also lead to liver cirrhosis. So, autoimmune disorders. Auto what? Autoimmune disorder. So, in autoimmune disorder, there is going to be production of antibodies. And those antibodies are going to be destroying the cells of the body. So, example is the liver cells. So, the antibodies are going to be destroying the liver cells. And when they are destroying the liver cells, it's going to let them become scarred. And fibrosis is going to set in. So, which means it can lead to what? Liver cirrhosis as well. So, a quick recap. We said liver cirrhosis is just a what? Is a progressive, or you say an irreversible scarring and fibrosis of the what? Of the liver. And we said it is also called the end stage liver damage, because it is irreversible, so it leads to death at last. So, and after that, we said the causes of liver cirrhosis are what? Alcoholism, any kind of injury to the liver, autoimmune disorder, hepatitis B virus, hepatitis C virus, and so on and so forth. So now, let's quickly rush into the pathophysiology of what? Of liver cirrhosis. But before that, I'd like to give you something called the Porter circulation. So because if you don't understand the Porter circulation, you're going to have a hard time getting what we want you to know about the pathophysiology of liver cirrhosis. So, stay tuned. Yeah, welcome back. So, I said I'm going to be talking about Porter circulation. Now, this Porter circulation, Water circulation. Water circulation. I'm not going to be giving you details, but I'm going to be giving you what you are going to need to understand the pathophysiology of liver cirrhosis. Now, go and know that we have the liver right here, located majorly in what? In the right hand hypochondrial region. So, we have the liver. So, it has to lose, divided by a pathophysiform ligament. If you like to watch our video on description of the liver, I'm going to drop a link up ahead, just make sure you check it. Or you can just go back there right now, so to get a better understanding of liver cirrhosis as well. So just go and check out the video on the description of the liver. Now, if this is the liver, for example. Now, this liver, right here we have the esophagus. The esophagus. It passes right behind the liver. And then it forms what? It forms stomach right here. Stomach. So it forms stomach. And the stomach forms what? Small intestine. So the C-shaped golden of small intestine. So we have the large intestine around here. And it started with an appendix. So the large intestine. So I want to be drawing something to gross. So let me just cut the large intestine like it. Let's stop it. Like this. And then this C-shaped structure, duodenum, the head of the pancreas, it invaginates into it. So which means behind these you are going to have the pancreas. So the pancreas. The pancreas right here. So just at this region, we have another structure here called spleen. So this is the spleen. So this structure here is stomach. So the stomach. And then here is the small intestine. So right here we have the pancreas. So not to waste too much of our time, let us assume that it's pancreas. So I don't want to give you something gross, not to be wasting much of our time. So this is the pancreas, the structure is pancreas. So this is the large intestine. So this is the appendix, cecum, ascending colon, hepatic region, transverse colon. Just read that, if you don't know it, just read it out. So right here we're going to have the sigmoid colon of the large intestine, which forms the rectum and arachne. So the sigmoid colon of the large intestine, and then rectum and arachne. So the sigmoid colon. So this part of the large intestine is the sigmoid colon. So all these organs, they are connected with the liver, but by what? By a vein called the portal vein. So let's assume that I want to give us the posterior view of the liver. So just at the posterior side of the liver. So just behind it. So we have this portal vein entering into the liver. So entering into what? Entering into the liver. So let's say this is the portal vein, for example. Portal vein. So this portal vein, it is connected with different blood vessels coming from what? Radiating from all these abdominal organs. So and the acronym for those five organs majorly is SPSSL. SPSSL. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So this S is the stomach. So this stomach. So blood vessels coming from the stomach. So let's pick it just this way. Let's talk about that. So the blood vessel. Let me change my makeup, please. So it's gonna be more clearer. So the blood vessel coming from the stomach. So the blood vessel comes from the what? Comes from the stomach. It's known as gastric vein. So because it's conveying blood away from the stomach. So the gastric vein is connected with this. It's connected with what? With this portal vein. So blood coming from the stomach is going to enter into the what? Into the gastric vein. So from the gastric vein, So it's going to go into the what? Into the portal vein. So that is the first thing. Now, the second one is the pancreas. So let's assume that we've picked the pancreas together like that. So that P is the pancreas. So the next S is the small intestine. Small what? Small intestine. So this structure right here, this C-shaped structure, small intestine. Although we still have bigger on this is the duodenum. Then we still have the ileum and the jejunum. They are also the part of the small intestine. But just to make this easier, that's why I'm bringing out these landmarks alone. So this small intestine has its own blood vessels too. So blood vessels. So, and that blood vessel, they are going to drain blood away from it, and they are going to empty into what? Into the portal. So for this small intestine, we call it the superior mesenteric artery. But let's look at it. If you don't know it, just go and watch my video on the liver. Or let's say our video on the liver, according to other members of this association. So just go and watch our video on what? On the small intestine. So you are going to understand this and you're going to know the video. And you are going to know the name of what? Of each of these blood vessels. So let's give the name for now. So blood vessel coming from the small intestine, so it's going to drain blood. So it drains blood from the what? From the small intestine. And then it drains into the what? Into the portal vein. So then this structure right here is called the spleen. So the spleen. So the spleen as well, it has its own way to the spleen vein. So passes just like this. So and then it's going to empty into the what? It's going to empty into this portal vein. Into the portal vein right here. So this red structure, the portal vein. Let me just put some kind of space here. So this is what the spleen vein. So blood is going to come from the spleen as well. Blood will come out from the spleen. So from there, it's going to begin empty into the what? Empty into the portal vein as well. So that is what the spleen, the next S. And the last L is the last L is the large intestine. So for this large intestine, this is the large intestine now. So blood coming from the large intestine as well. So it's going to be drained into the what? Into the portal vein. So blood comes from what? From different parts of the large intestine. So same thing, this is a part of the large intestine too. But the woman wants to be drained into over structures. So the blood is going to move this way. So and it is going to be emptied into what? It's going to be emptied into the portal vein. So the portal vein. If you notice all these arrows, they are coming from different organs. So, for example, now this is the gastric vein coming from the stomach. Blood is going to leave the stomach and it's going to come into what? Into the portal vein. So, same thing from what? From this small intestine. So, from these three guys right here. So, drain it into what? Into the portal vein. Large intestine, same thing. Then the spleen too. So, it is going to drain what? It's going to drain its blood into what? Into the portal vein. And all this blood are going to enter into what? They are going to enter into the liver. So that is just portal circulation in a bit. So why do we need to understand portal circulation in the pathophysiology of liver cirrhosis? So when we start talking about it, you are going to understand. So let me just bring it out and let's start with the pathophysiology of liver cirrhosis proper. So stay tuned. Yeah, welcome back. So we're talking about the pathophysiology of what? Of the liver cirrhosis. Pathophysiology of liver cirrhosis. Now, we said the causes of liver cirrhosis can be a damage to the what? Any kind of damage to the liver cells. So we said alcohol can damage the liver cells. We said hepatitis B virus, hepatitis C virus, autoimmune, where antibodies produced by the body that is supposed to be vigilant against the foreign bodies, and they're supposed to be killing the foreign bodies, they are going to be killing the body cells, such as the liver cells. So, we also talked about what? We talked about injury, a normal injury. So, anything that can lead to what? The damage of the liver cells. Damage of what? Damage of the liver cells. So, which means the pathophysiology of liver cirrhosis starts from what? Damage to the liver cells. Or is it damage of what? Damage of the liver cells. Now, within the liver, what does it look like? Now, let's say we have the liver right here. So, the liver. So, this is the liver. So, I have the liver right here. So, if this is the liver, we know it has two lobes. Majorly, actually. you also have four lobes. It has four lobes actually. Just check the video on the liver. Now, within this liver is made of lobes. So, each lobe is a hexagonal shape. So, this hexagonal lobe, they have all worked with other cells. Why don't we dig in deep into that? Just take this from here as they are being hit within the water, within the liver cells. So, if I'm to take a careful look, or if I'm to magnify rather, if I'm to magnify the diagram of the liver, the structure of the liver, it's going to give us this structure right here. And what is that? So, I'm going to have the liver cells. Liver cells. Just like this. Liver cell, they are arranged in rows. They are arranged in what? In rows. So these are their nuclei. So as in, they are just on a straight line. And you know, if there are some group of people on a straight line, it means they are going to have an empty space by the right and an empty space by the left. So I've explained these while talking about the distribution of the liver. But I just want to know that as these guys are aligned on a row, they have a free side here and another free side here. It means we can have another row right here and another row right here. So, but for this free space, we have what we call the bloodstream there. The blood what? The bloodstream. It's a kind of blood capillary called the sinusoid capillary. So right here, we have the blood. We have the blood. And you will realize that between these liver cells, these liver cells are called hepatocytes. Hepatocytes. So on this other side, we still have bile. But we are not talking about bile today. When we reach jaundice, maybe obstructive jaundice, we'll be talking about it. But what we need now is just within the liver, we have hepatocyte and what? And blood capillaries. So this blood capillary, we have a space between it and the hepatocytes. So this space between this hepatocyte and this blood capillary, this space is called the sinusoidal space. It means a space peri that surrounds the sinusoid capillary. So this blood vessel is the sinusoid capillary. That's why I watch our video on the liver. That's why I gave you an advice beforehand. Just go with the liver. Then come back. So back to what we were discussing for those who have watched our video on the liver. So this place is called the perisinusoidal space. It's the space between the hepatocyte and what? And this sinusoid capillary. So within this space, we have some cells there. We have some what? Some cells there. So these cells, they are called stellate cells. Stellate cells. So their function is to store vitamin E. I've talked about this in the description of the liver. So these stellate cells, their function is to do what? Is to store vitamin A. But this is just the normal structure of what? Of the liver, the inner part of the liver. So when the liver is healthy, this is what it looks like. We have a row of what? Of cells. So and on either side, we have bile inside the bile canaliculi, and we have the what? Blood inside the sinusoid capillary. So this is what it looks like normally. But in liver cirrhosis, I said there is going to be a damage to the what? To the liver cells. Now let's assume that this liver cell, they are damaged. So they are damaged. Let's assume that they are what? They are damaged. So just imagine that a part of your body is damaged. You know, you're going to feel pain. And if you are still childish, you're going to cry. So, what's for these liver cells? Just take it from me like that. They are child as well. So, they are going to cry. So, they are going to secrete their tears. But you don't call it tears. In message, you call them chemicals. Chemicals. So when the hepatocytes, the liver cells, whenever they are damaged, they secrete what? They secrete some kind of chemicals. Now look at these chemicals. It is directed towards what? Towards the stellate cells. And the function of the stellate cells is to do what? Is to store vitamin A. Now, we know that because these stellate cells, they've been affected by what? By these chemicals. They won't be able to store vitamin A again. They're going to lose their function. Because they have to sympathize for their mates. They are both living inside the liver. So they have to sympathize. So they are going to drop their function. So they will be able to do what? They will be able to store vitamin A. But that is just an electrical mode. That is not what we are going to do. We are talking about liver cirrhosis here. Now, whenever they are damaged to what? They are damaged to the liver cells. So the liver cells are going to secrete what? Some kind of secretions or chemicals. And these chemicals is going to act on what? It's going to act on what? On the stellate cells. And when this chemical, when it acts on the stellate cells,
the stellar cells will lose their function. They won't be able to do what? They won't be able to store vitamin A again. On the other hand, they will become activated. That's what has happened. So, and when they become activated, they are going to respond by secreting another chemical stimulus. So, they are going to respond by secreting what we call TGF-beta-1. So, let me magnify that. I said it's T, so the T is transforming TG. G is growth, and F, that F is factor. So, transforming growth factor B1, beta-1. So, that's TGF-B1. So, these telomere cells are going to secrete what? The transforming growth factor beta-1. They are going to secrete it where? They are going to secrete it in the perisinusoidal space. They will start secreting it in the what? In the perisinusoidal space. So, they will start secreting it in the what? In the perisinusoidal space. Now, this transforming growth factor will now lead to the formation of all these trias, all these lines that I'm giving right here. So, and that is what we call collagen. Collagen. And the collagen will later become, will later accumulate and form fibrosis. So, there is going to be development of what? Of fibrous tissue from the what? From the collagen produced due to the presence of what? Due to the presence of TGF-beta-1. Now, a quick recap. I know it's becoming cumbersome if I can use that word. So, now, the hepatocyte now, they are going to do what? Whenever they are damaged, they are going to release some kind of secretions, which will act on what? On the stellate cells. So, the stellate cells will become activated. And when they are activated, they will start secreting TGF-beta-1, which is transforming growth factor beta-1. And now, this transforming growth factor beta-1 will lead to the formation of collagen. And formation of collagen excessively is going to cause fibrosis. And that is where your liver cirrhosis comes in. We said cirrhosis means what? An irreversible scarring and what? And fibrosis. So the scarring and fibrosis will result due to what? Due to the secretion of TGF-beta-1 by what? By the stellate cells. And the TGF-beta-1 will cause production of what? Of collagen. And collagen leads to what? Fibrosis. Do you get that? Now, let me just give you a chart so you won't forget. Just know that the hepatocyte. Hepatocytes, they are going to release some kind of secretions. And then our arrow, secretion will act on the stellate cells. Stellate what? Stellate cells. And now, the stellate cells are going to secrete TGF-beta-1. And TGF-beta-1 is from collagen. And from collagen, it's going to develop into fibrosis. It's going to cause fibrosis. So that is exactly what is happening. Information of what? Formation of fibrous tissue. So, now, look at this. Very careful, look at this. Just imagine. We said we have cells on this side and blood inside this blood capillary called the sinusoid capillary. So, with the fact that there is accumulation of fibrous tissue here, it is going to be compressing this what? This innocent sinusoid capillary. So, and it is going to be what? It is going to be obstructing the movement of blood into the liver. Do you get that? So, the fibrous tissue, excessive scarring and fibrosis, is going to be what? It's going to be compressing the sinusoid capillary. So, excessive scarring. So, excessive fibrosis. It's going to be what? It's going to be compressing the what? The sinusoid capillary. Do you get that? And it means blood will not be able to do it. Will not be able to pass through the liver again. Because we said this is happening inside the liver. Now, don't forget, I just explained the blood circulation to you. So, the blood circulation is bringing blood into the liver. It means this, the beginning of this lesson that I put here is the portal vein. The portal what? The portal vein, which means blood is going to be going back by that. So, this eventually will cause portal hypertension and blood is going to be going back. And that is where the knowledge of blood circulation comes in. So, let me just put this here. Okay, let me just put the words and come back again with the explanation and then continue with the part of the synergy. So, stay tuned. Yeah, welcome back. So, we're talking about what the path of the synergy of what? Of liver cirrhosis. So, let me quickly bring in the diagram and then I'm going to finish up the path of the synergy in just 2 seconds from now. Now, we have the liver. Let me use the mapping. So, the diagram becomes operation once again. So, we have our what? We have our liver right here.
So the liver, so it has two lobes, majorly. So now we have the what? The esophagus. So passing behind it, and then it forms the what? It forms the stomach. Forms the stomach. And it forms the small intestine actually. So, stomach. So the small intestine. My stomach is not really good. That's it, it's well. J-shaped organ. Good. Yeah. So, stomach, the small intestine. Then right here we have the pancreas. So the pancreas. So the pancreas. And then right here we have the spleen. So let's put this ilum, the ilum of the spleen, I still remember. So you should have. Then we have our last intestine, starting from the appendix, finger-like projection. So not to take up much of our space, I'm just going to deliver right here. So it's going to run like this from the transverse colon. From the transverse colon, it comes downward like this. To form the what? To form the descending colon. And that's going to form the what? The S shape, what do you call this? Sigmoid colon. And then it forms the rectum and anal. So let's take it that way. So that is the thinner colon. I hope you remember that. So that's not happening to actually. Let's not do much on that. Let's stop wasting the time. Now, these are the intestines, so I don't want to be running too much. Now, we know that these are the five organs that is connected to the what? To the portal vein. So I told us that if I am to show you the what? The posterior view of the liver, I said you are going to have the portal vein right here. So the portal vein entering into the what? Entering into the liver. Let me use a red pen, a red marker rather for that. So the portal vein. So portal vein. So this is the what? The portal vein. The portal vein. So, I said, the portal vein is connected to what? To this, to the stomach. So through the gastric vein. So the gastric vein is going to drain blood away from the stomach. And then, talked about these two. So splenic vein. So splenic vein. So the splenic vein connects to this, and then for the intestine too, intestine too, vessel of the intestine, so superior mesenteric, so it's connected to what? The portal vein, and then the large intestine too, large intestine, so this is part of the large intestine. So, large intestine. So, the large intestine connected to what? To this portal vein. So, all the structures are connected to what? They are connected to what? To the portal vein. And they are taking blood to the what? Into the liver. Blood is coming from what? From the stomach. And this is fragile area. To the what? To the stomach. I mean, to the liver. Same thing with the what? With the spleen. So, this is the spleen. See the stomach. Stomach. So this is the pancreas. So this is the small intestine. Small intestine. And large intestine. So same thing here. Large intestine. So appendix right here, don't need it. So these are superior and inferior mesenteric artery. So let's leave that for some other time. Now, in liver cirrhosis, I said inside the liver, let's say these are the rows of what? Hepatocytes. So these are the stellate cells. So this portal vein is going to form the what? It's going to form that sinusoid capillary that I was telling you about in the previous slide. So these stellate cells now, whenever this cell, whenever they are damaged, they are going to produce some kind of secretion which will activate the what? The stellate cells. And the stellate cells is going to produce TGF-beta-1, which is going to form what? Collagen at this junction. So, We have some other rules of what? Hepatocytes right here. So that is how the liver is arranged. Just now, what our video on the liver. So, we have to tell it cells here too. Because this is what? The perisinusoid aspect. So, when the stellate cells are activated, both here and here, they produce TGF beta 1, and this is going to cause production of what? Production of collagen. And the collagen is going to lead to fibrous tissue and scarring as well, because damage has occurred. So, if you watch our video on inflammation, you realize that scarring is the last phase of inflammation. But they don't want to go in there. And inflammation is what? Is a non-specific response to tissue injury. We have not, I'll also drop a link on inflammation ahead, so you can check it after the video, so you get a better understanding of this as well. So, this region, stellate cells, is going to lead to production of what? Of collagen. And that collagen is going to form fibrous tissue. So, and then, it is going to do what? It is going to constrict, or it is going to strangulate the what? The portamen. And when this occurs, blood is not going to move into the what? Into the liver again. On the other hand, the blood is going to be coming back. So, right here, portal hypertension will be occurring. Portal hypertension. So, portal hypertension means increasing the pressure of what? Of the portal vein. So, on the norms, the portal vein should be moving easily with just a normal pressure, minimal pressure. But because this place is becoming occluded, the blood will have to increase its pressure to force its way through. That's why we say portal hypertension is occurring at this point. So, portal hypertension will lead to what? Backflow of blood. Backflow of what? Backflow of blood into the what? Into the portal vein. And from there, the blood is going to be going back to their different routes. So, blood is going to be going back to what? To the stomach and this place, this esophagus. And backflow of blood. Now we've started the negative synergy. So, we are going to be using what? We are going to be using this concentration to dish out all the what? All the negative synergy of liver cirrhosis. So, backflow of blood to this stomach part, this gastric part, and so and the esophageal part. It's going to cause what we call esophageal varices. Esophageal varices. So when blood is just congested in the what? In the blood vessels of the what? Of the esophagus and the stomach. So this will predispose the person to what? To bleeding. So the person can what? Can be vomiting blood. So that's what we call hematemesis. That's another sign and symptom. Hematemesis. So what is the meaning of that? The word hemat in front, is the not blood. Hemesis means vomiting. So the person will be vomiting what? The person will be vomiting blood. So after that, we said the blood they are going to be coming back to what? To where they are going to they are going to be going back to where they are coming from. So the blood leaving the spleen is going to be going straight up back into what? Into the spleen. And now, because this blood is going to be going back into the spleen, there will be an enlargement of the spleen. So, and when the spleen becomes enlarged, it's going to cause another sign and symptom. So we call it splenomegaly. Splenomegaly. The word spleno is denoting the spleen. O is a conduction. The word megaly means enlargement. For something to become enlarged. So the spleen will become big. So blood is going to be coming back to the what? To the spleen. Now, there is going to be a kind of disadvantage here for the body. Because this spleen is referred according to some other textbook as the graveyard of red blood cells. So we have different organs in the body that serve as a graveyard. But the spleen is part of it too. It means it kills the blood cells of our body. So such as the what? The white blood cell, the red blood cell, and the what? And the platelets. Now tell me, when all the blood are not coming back, they are shunting, they are going back into the spleen, which makes the spleen become enlarged. So when the spleen becomes enlarged, the blood inside the spleen is going to be subjected to destruction. The spleen is going to be destroying them. It's just as if this room I'm in. For an example, let's say this room is just the room of a Grim Reaper. For those people who don't know what Grim Reaper is, Grim Reaper are those people who used to kill. So they used to give them some kind of weird appearance. They hold the keys, so they are skeletal. So, okay, let's just say the Indelopet. So this room belongs to the Indelopet. So if human beings are forced to pile up, to be piled up inside this room, regardless of their number, they are going to be getting killed. And more people will still be coming in. So this room now is a spleen, and the humans are what? The blood coming into it. So, as blood is getting into the spleen will be destroying them. And more blood is going to be coming back. As they are being drained away from this place, they are going to be diverting into what? Into the spleen. And now, because the red blood cells is being constantly destroyed by the what? By the spleen, that is going to reduce the amount of red blood cells in the body. And that is all called anemia. So, anemia is going to set in. So, anemia. So, the A or an in front, in anatomy, it means no, absence, or reduced. So, NM is blood. So, reduction in what? In blood cells. In red blood cells, precise. So, now, after that, that is that for the red blood cell. Now, for the white blood cells, they are going to be destroyed too. And this is going to cause a term called leukopenia. It's going to lead to leukopenia. So, reduction in the amount of red blood cell because of its constant destruction. So, leukopenia. So, let me do this way. Let me put it here. Leukopenia. So, it means reduction in what? In the amount of white blood cell. Now, let me ask you a question. What would that lead to? The function of white blood cells to do what? Is to give some kind of defense to the body to protect us against infection. But these guys, they are getting reduced. It means our body is prone to infection. So, that's another thing that leukopenia is going to lead to. So, we are going, that person is going to be prone to opportunistic infection. So, the last type of blood cell is what? Is platelet that causes thrombocytes. So, there is going to be a reduction in the amount of thrombocytes too. And that is what we call thrombocytopenia. Thrombocytopenia. So, thrombocytopenia. So, now this thrombocytopenia, what is it going to cause? We have to ask ourselves the function of thrombocytes. So, they help in clotting. So they help in blood clot so that there will be minimized escape of blood whenever you have any kind of wound. So, if we now have a low level of thrombocytes, it means our blood will not be able to clot easily when we have injury. And this is going to lead to bleeding of different body parts. So, it is going to lead to pituitary.
So, those are other signs and symptoms. Pituitary. So, ecchymosis. So, all this kind of bleeding under skin. So, you can check out the sign to get a better understanding of this.
So, that is what was reduction in the level of thrombocytes is going to cause. Now, a quick recap of fibrosis. I said destruction of these hepatocytes is going to lead to what? Formation of what? Of fibrosis within the liver. And fibrosis is going to strangulate the hepatic and the essential capillary. And then it's going to lead to backflow of blood into the what? Into the portal vein. And then blood is going to be going back to what? Their different destinations. So we said it's going to cause further viruses there. And it means it is going to be prone to what? To bleeding. So the person can be vomiting blood as an emesis. So then we'll talk about what the spleen too. The spleen, blood is going to be shunted into it. So blood is going to be accumulated into the spleen. And that is what we call what? Spleen megaly, because it will become enlarged. And then the function of the spleen is to do what? Is to destroy the blood cells. And when it starts destroying them, anemia will set in because of reducing the amount of what? Of red blood cells. Reduction in the amount of white blood cells will cause leukopenia. And then thrombocytes will cause thrombocytopenia. So for leukopenia, it's going to maintain as what? As the person being prone to what? Opportunistic infections. So for thrombocytopenia, so that is going to lead to what? This is going to lead to bleeding tendencies. Bleeding tendencies. So exactly, spectra chain, ecchymosis, and so on and so forth. So it can even also lead to what we call spider angiomara. But I don't want to put it there. So we have spider angiomata, we have the palmar ecchymosis, and we have one more, gynecomastia. They are due to the effect of liver cirrhosis, but I'm yet to reach the other pathology. Just stay tuned. Now, after that, this blood is going to go back to the what? To the intestines too. And when it goes back to the intestine, it's going to lead to GIT disturbance. So it can manifest as what? As constipation. Constipation and what? And diarrhea. It can lead to constipation and diarrhea. So engorgement of blood in the what? It's the intestine and the large intestine. So here we have the what? We have the rectum. This is the rectum. So backflow of blood to the what? To the rectal area of the large intestine is going to lead to cause or what we call hemorrhoid gradually. Hemorrhoid. So that is the varicose vein of the water of the anal canal rectum. So same thing with all this part. This part will be manifested as diarrhea and constipation. So that is that for the portal hypertension. So the portal hypertension part of what? Of liver cirrhosis. So is this the only effect of liver cirrhosis? No. I'm very sorry. You still have to grant me 5 minutes more, and then you are going to run the rest of the. So I'm going to clear the board with a quick recap one more time for this. So, due to what? Fibrosis of the liver, backflow of blood will come to the stomach, secretory viruses, bleeding tendencies from the mouth, hematemesis. So, and then it also leads to what? Backflow of blood to the spleen, and the spleen will become enlarged, splenomegaly. And after that, this is going to lead to destruction of our blood cells, anemia, leukopenia, pituitary. So, this can be the complications you get that. So, and then
backflow of blood to the intestinal regions can cause what? Hemorrhoid at the rectum, and then for the large small intestine, constipation and diarrhea. So, and then due to bleeding tendencies here, the person can have potential ecchymosis, spider and GMR. So let's just clear the board. Oh, statement, sorry.
Yeah, welcome back.
So, we talked about portal hypertension under liver cirrhosis. So, now I have a question for you. All these organs that I've been drawing, or let me say in the previous scene, they are the organ of the GIT. So, they are within our what? The abdomen. And don't forget, this organ, they are covered by what? They are covered by peritoneum. So, if let's say we have a patient suffering from liver cirrhosis. So, this is the person's neck, let's assume. Then, this is the person's head. So, then, we have the person's chest. Okay, let's do this way. The person's chest like this. And then, the abdomen. So, then the person's legs. So, the person's legs right here. So, the person's legs are the person sitting on the chair. On the chair. So, sitting on the chair. So, So, let's take it like that. So the abdominal organs, all those organs will be drawing the liver, the small intestine, to the rectum, they're just going to be around this region. And they are going to be covered by what? By peritoneum, a double-walled membrane. So, because blood is flowing back to this abdominal organ, there is something that is still going to happen that our body does not intend. And what is that? There is going to be a fluid sheet from those abdominal organs, as blood is going back to them, they are going to be opening into what? Into the peritoneum. So I don't want to be talking about the flap of the peritoneum. You know that's close to you. So if you don't know it, all the best. So now, the blood is going to be what? There is going to be an escape of fluid into this what? Into this peritoneum. This is the backflow of blood, rather. Sorry, to do what? To those organs. So the organ is going to leak out fluid into the what? Into the peritoneum, because the peritoneum itself is a permeable membrane. It's a semi what? It's a semi permeable membrane. That is the simplest expansion that I can give to it now. So we are going to be dealing with the peritoneum some other time. So now, and this is going to cause another symptom that we call ascites. Aside what? Ascites. So that one, aside. Now, don't forget, it is the liver that is diseased. It is the liver that is what? That is diseased in this condition. Then you are going to remind me the function of the liver. So one of the functions of the liver is detoxification. Detoxification. So the liver is responsible for doing what? For detoxifying some hormones. So detoxifying hormones. Such as what? Such as estrogen. Go and watch our last video on the liver. You are going to understand this better. So it is responsible for doing what? For breaking down. For breaking down what? For breaking down estrogen. But because it is diseased, it won't be able to break down estrogen. And then there is going to be what? There is going to be an increase in the level of estrogen. So what will that cause? In male, it is going to cause what we call gynecomastia. Gynecomastia. So the male is going to have a big breast, just like that of the female. So this is the effect of estrogen. So I think I've dropped the video on menstruation. No! If I have done that, I would have explained something about estrogen, but let's explain it now. In short, accumulation of estrogen is going to cause what? It's going to cause gynecomastia. And then it can lead to some other signs and symptoms called spider and GMR. Spider and GMR. Spider and GMR. So, then, the primary chemo system. So, and so on and so forth. So, other functions of the liver, that's metabolism, all those things that are going to be impaired. All these functions are going to be what? They are going to be impaired. So, we are not going to do them anymore. I think we can just call it a stop for that. And don't forget, the liver is responsible for producing bile too. So, the bile is going to flow back into the what? Into the blood. And then the person is going to have jaundice as a complication too. So, I'll just stop right here. So, I think that you enjoyed this video. So, if you do, make sure you give it a thumbs up. But let me just quickly recap. So, I said liver cirrhosis. It's just what? An irreversible scan and fibrosis of the liver. And I said it can be caused by injury, alcoholism, hepatitis B virus, hepatitis C virus, so autoimmune and so forth that can damage the hepatocytes, that is the liver cells. So, and after that, I said about physiology, you have to understand the portal circulation. So we said backflow of blood from the what? from the portal vein into the digestive organ, will lead to what? Will lead to engorgement. So like backflow of blood to the stomach, which is going to cause cardiac varices, and then bleeding from the mouth. So hemochromatosis. So we talked about what? Going back to the spleen, splenomegaly, and that is going to continue destroying them, anemia resetting, thrombocytopenia resetting, leukopenia resetting. So that we said all those things that are going to lead to what? Other bleeding like ecchymosis and Peter Chi and the likes. So we also talked about backflow to the large intestine and small intestine, causing constipation and diarrhea alternatively. We talked about backflow of blood to the rectum, causing what? Hemorrhage. And then we talked about fluid shift into the peritoneum, because the peritoneum is a central membrane, that is going to cause ascites. And then we talked about some function of the liver, starts breaking out of some wounds, so that's estrogen. And when estrogen cannot be broken down, it's going to cause organomyosis and spider angioma, so myosis. And then the liver as well is responsible for doing what? It is responsible for producing albumin. So now imagine the person is not having albumin in the blood. What is going to happen? So if you are following our video, I will link the answer to you. So that is the end for today's video. So I take it that you enjoy it. So if you do, do make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if this is your first time watching the video from this episode, just do make sure you subscribe and you hit the bell button so we can inspire you by doing it. Hi guys.